Matt Preston is the larger-than-life foodie with a big mouth. Not our words, his. Matt's new memoir is called Big Mouth. It's a collection of stories on everything, from his two birth certificates to his biggest on-air blunders. Would you please welcome Matt Preston? I mean, this is it. Big, by the way,
where do you want to start?
Well, your suit is so well coordinated with the
colour. I thought of that this afternoon. I thought this would work really nicely.
But you're naked.
Well, I am underneath, but
yeah. No,
up here. It's 30 degrees.
You don't wear it in, there's no stomach for that?
No, I don't have a neoprene, like underwater cravat or anything like that. a little kind of wet-look cravat. No, it seemed perfect to go cravat-free today, because it's such a beautiful day.
Were you often called Big Mouth?
You know what it is? It's that idea that when someone asks you for the title of the book, there are two ways it goes. Either you spend 8 months and focus groups and it takes, and then, or someone just says and the words come out of your mouth. And this is what happened. Literally, it was like, I'll call it Big Mouth because I've got a big mouth and my mouth is really what I've made my kind of, I suppose, what's taken me to some amazing places.
Pinch the title that I wanted to use, thanks.
Well, in fairness, I think Morrissey probably, Big Mouth Strikes Again is the inspiration. But yeah, you don't need a smiling mouth, the new Steve Price. Mr. Mellow.
Thank you, Matt.
Beautiful Matt Preston, we have learned many wonderful things about you today, and one of them has been that you have been sending these secret signals.
Yeah, I was doing it just now, actually.
Were you? Who are you sending the signals to?
The woman I love. When I was on MasterChef, we filmed 4 years up in Sydney, so left my wife behind with three small children under five, which, as you know, is one of the worst things possibly you can do. So to let her know I was thinking of her, I just twist the wedding ring. Like that. Because, you know, you've got to think of ways of sending signals, and when you're on set for 17 hours, you know, you can do to think about. So you used to do that, which is a, you know...
Very romantic kind of you.
So romantic.
Well, I'm not so romantic if I'm like an hour and a half flight away and not doing the nappies and helping with the bath time.
Great thing being like, yep, that'll do it. That's right. We're even now.
No, that's exactly right. A typical male reaction. Yeah. That'll work. Yeah. No.
Great thing about the book is we learn things that we all know you really well. We do. Things we never knew about you. You came to Australia and started contributing back to English magazines writing about soap operas.
Yeah, that's right. I was.
That was your income.
That was my income. I'd worked for a magazine in the UK, and when I came over, they said, a couple of them said, well, look, can you file stories back on Neighbours and Home and Away? For 5 years, I watched every single episode of Neighbours and Home and Away and reported back on it. And I was for, you know, very seldom you get to call yourself the world's expert in something.
Yes. But
in about 1995, I was the world's number one Neighbours expert.
Were you beating the stories up? Were you sort of exaggerating to get a good headline?
You didn't need to with Neighbours. I mean, at the end of the day, you know, with soap operas, if someone goes for a picnic, they'll get shot by a duck hunter, bitten by a redback spider. all human life is there. Or there'll be sharks, undoubtedly. Certainly Summer Bay, undoubtedly sharks.
You're such an expert, you're writing new episodes now.
Yeah. I mean, could, please.
And you're in the military. You don't strike me as a military person.
Can we look at the photo of you in the military, by the way? There he is.
Yeah.
Look at this.
You got a beret on.
Look, my family, there was no money to send me to university, so I came up with this brilliant idea. I'd go and get a thing called a bursary, and they give you just enough money to pay to go to university. We didn't have to go to the army, didn't have to do anything, right? I went, I did the interview, I came back a month later, they gave me a scholarship and said, by the way, turn up at Sandhurst, which is the Lake Duntroon, and you'll spend an 11-week course. And we'll do it in 3 weeks. So it was incredibly intense, really hard, super scary. Everyone else had been in some sort of army corps. I had no idea how to march. So you can imagine, it was just a disaster. It was 3 weeks of disaster, and I came out. But, you know, I went to university, and that was good.
Fantastic.
I've got a cravat-based question.
Yes.
We've learnt today, well, I've learnt, some other people knew this, that the cravats, preceded MasterChef. I thought it was a MasterChef-based thing.
Oh, I thought you were going to ask a question about where it comes from Croatia and how they used to wear it to identify Croatian military mercenaries.
Would you like, to answer the question that you'd prefer?
No.
Apparently cravats come from the Croatian military.
Yeah. I did, because I used to be a punk. So when you went to punk concerts, people would rip your clothes off and the buttons would all go. And so when you went home on the cold bus, you'd like to have a little scarf around your neck. So that's where it started. So it started with that. It was practical and sensible. And I think I've got I've got a picture of me wearing one 17, 18. So, yeah, it was always... So it wasn't... I think a lot of people thought when it came on TV and someone in a brains trust in Channel 10 went, this man's wear a cravat. This man must mangle the English language. You know, it was literally that's... Yeah. They got what we got. And I really, that piece of material was probably the reason why I got the job in MasterChef in the first place.
I've also learnt today that you grew up in some rough neighbourhoods. Was the cravat ever an issue?
Luckily, that was when I was 17 and 18. I'd moved slightly nicer. But, yeah, it would have been. Yeah, cravat wearing is not something you do in tough parts of town.
Although now I associate it with punk rock.
You obviously were the world's neighbours expert forever, and you got to meet Dr. Carl.
I did, yes.
But you also got to meet Neil Armstrong. The first. Yeah. I think we've got a photo of you doing that here. What I want to know is, which meeting thrilled you more?
Oh, my... Well, I reckon I think I'm nine. Imagine being a nine-year-old boy and literally that year, Neil Armstrong has landed on the moon. It's been the biggest event of like 40 years since the war ended, really. And then you get to meet him and you're like, because you met an astronaut recently, didn't you? How exciting was that? Now imagine you are a nine-year-old boy and you meet the first man to step on the moon.
And you shook his hand.
And I shook his hand and I stepped on my nephew's foot, which you can see in the picture. There's a small kid in the background. Poor cousin, that's right. He didn't get to shake anything.
How did that compare to Dr. Carl?
Far better the first time I met Dr. Carl, comparative with doing, because working with 10, you get to do make a cameo. I made a cameo with Dr. Carl on the 30th anniversary week of Neighbours. About the only thing my mother ever said, well done to me on, because she loved Neighbours, and to be there and to do a scene with Dr. Carl, the man that, you know.
Right.
I mean, on Oscar awarding winning speeches, people say Carl inspires them. So, he's an unprecedented gem.
You finally made it, kid. That's right.
Well, it's one of the three things I wanted to do. Yeah. Be on Rove, Dr. Carl, go to the Logies.
Doesn't figure. Oh, well, we'll just move on.
It comes out, Matt Preston, you are wonderful. We adore you. Would you please thank Matt Preston?